Precious Jesus. Hallelujah. God be glorified in the season of higher grace, the season of 2020, the year of our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessings, greetings, and may grace be upon your lives as we meet again tonight in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We want to just thank God for this wonderful day and the week that we've had. We know that God is still in control of our lives as he continues to. He never leaves us nor forsakes us. We thank God for his divine love for us. God never abandons his children. He has always graciously continued to be with us. So we continue on our journey tonight, and I want to thank God for what he has done in our lives. We continue to pray. We know that the partial door for our ministries have opened. We want to continue to pray that the full doors will be open, that we may meet in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. And we are aware that by grace, this coming weekend, we can go back to our churches. Amen. And we thank God for that particular blessing that God has given us. So on this journey, we've been talking about the glorious nature, the personality of the Holy Spirit. We want to just thank God that the Holy Spirit is a wonderful person in our lives. And we honor him for that, because Jesus Christ decided to release the Holy Spirit upon our lives and allow him to come to be with us as the comforter, as the helper in our lives. In our introduction, we learned that there are benefits. There are benefits why the Holy Spirit has been released to us. There are many benefits because, first of all, he has been revealed to us as sons of God. We are sons of God. So as a child of God, you are beneficiary to the benefits of the Holy Spirit. The knowledge of the Holy Spirit can help you to be radical. It can help you to know your life. It can help you in your prayers. It can help you in your faith. It can help you in many ways. It can help you in your stand in the things of God. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit is our helper throughout. He never leaves us nor forsakes us. And we thank God for that, because the Holy Spirit is the solution to all our problems. He is the solution to problems of life, personal lives, individual lives, family lives. He is the solution to national lives and every human being on the planet Earth. So you and I need the grace and the help of the Holy Spirit. We have learned on the journey that the Holy Spirit is God's desire that we may know him. He's a person. He's a third in the Trinity. And being the third in the Trinity, he's exactly like God Almighty, the Father. He's also exactly like God, the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. So the Holy Spirit is the answer to a lot of problems. He is the answer to every situation, every difficulty thing that you may be going through. The Holy Spirit is the answer. Without the Holy Spirit, you can never go far in our lives. Amen. So we thank God for this help that God has given us through the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is that supernatural person who has a nature, and he also has work in our lives. Amen. So we learned that the Holy Spirit has impact upon the believer. The impact that he has upon you and me is to bring you health, to bring you help, and also to bring you divine destiny. The Holy Spirit's desire is that he may lead you and me every day of our lives, in our business, in the family. Maybe you're about to make a decision over something that is so important in your life. You need the help of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit can help you to make that decision. Once you pray, you'll be comfortable with the decision you've made, and you know that God is in charge. So the Holy Spirit does a lot of wonderful things in our lives. And as he does those wonderful things in our lives, it's important that we understand the journey and the impact that he has over several things in our lives. Now, we also note that the Holy Spirit makes intercession for us. He creates an impact in our lives so that we may be able to intercede. There are many Christians who are unable to pray correctly. Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit would like to bring you to that level where you can pray correctly, where you know when you have left the throne of prayer that you have been in the grace of God. You've been in the presence of God without a shadow of doubt. You walk away even with the excitement. You walk away with the anointing. You walk away knowing that God was really with you. You were on the journey before God of prayer. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit helps us to intercede, as we learned in Romans chapter 8, verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit, meaning the Holy Spirit, also helps our infirmities, our normal weaknesses, our human weaknesses, our inabilities to pray. The Holy Spirit helps you to learn to pray. He helps you to enjoy prayer. It becomes a wonderful thing to you. You know that when you got a challenge, you can take it somewhere else. And that somewhere else is in the presence of God. Whenever you are challenged by a problem, the Holy Spirit will enable you to know how to pray. Amen. And so as you know how to pray, you enjoy prayer. Prayer becomes part of your life. You spend hours in prayer. You spend different moments in prayer. You pray in the morning, you pray in the afternoons, you pray in the night. You pray so many times, as much as you can, because the Holy Spirit is helping you to know how to pray. He intercedes on our behalf. Romans 8:26, likewise the Spirit also helps our infirmities. For we do not know what we should pray as we ought to. As we ought to. So there is a way in which we should be praying. There is a way in which we should be praying according to the word of God, according to the grace given us. So the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, helps us to bring those words out. He helps us to bring those cries out. You can cry before God in the presence and the leading of the Holy Spirit. He helps us to groan, those groaning. He helps us when to shout hallelujah. He helps us when to declare, Jehovah, you are great. He takes us in tongues, and he also brings us in the natural word, which we know. So he helps us come to God in his presence by the leading of the words, the atmosphere, and the language that is he gives us. Hallelujah. So on the journey as a child of God, you need to know how to pray, especially when you are a problem. I have seen people, when they have a problem, they don't know how to pray. They lose the scriptures. They can't remember the word of God. They can't remember where to start from. They don't know which way to begin to pray. So the Holy Spirit comes to help us to pray. He calms down your fear so that you can start to pray correctly. You may start to pray well. You start by worshiping God. You start by thanking God for who he is. You remind God of his greatness. You remind God of his power and his authority in your prayer. By the time you get into that realm, when you come to mention your need, you have already been in the presence of God correctly. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit helps us to pray. And it's my prayer that you may know how to pray, how to intercede. It is possible that if you are sensitive to the Holy Spirit, you will discover that in most times when you are probably busy, the Holy Spirit may drop somebody's name in your mind. So the Holy Spirit is saying, intercede for that person. You may not know why. It happens to me many times. I want to do something, I'm thinking of somebody. I ignore it, and then the Holy Spirit prompts it again. Then I realize I need to pray for that person. I may not know what I'm interceding for, but because I'm in tune with the Holy Spirit, I'm able to intervene over the situation of that particular person. That is what the Holy Spirit wants you to do. Amen. When you think about somebody, you may be playing with your mobile phone and you come across somebody that, you know, you pause for a while for a reason. The reason is so that you may be able to know how to pray. Hallelujah. I pray that we may not quench the Holy Spirit when he empowers us to pray. We also, on the journey, have understood that the Holy Spirit creates an impact in our praise. The Holy Spirit wants us to praise the Lord. Praise is a dimension in which warfare can happen and you can win victories. When you learn to worship God, when you learn to praise God, to sing with the anointing, to release grace through in rhythms, in songs, in praise, you'll be able to conquer a lot of battles in your life. So the Holy Spirit helps us in all this so that we enjoy holy praise, not just singing songs. I remember before Lord, the church I used to go to, I'll not mention it. You know, we used to sing songs composed by people which were meaningless at all. Hallelujah. They were absolutely meaningless. The rhythm was good, but there was no content in the words. There was nothing to glorify God. There was nothing even connected to the Bible. We sang songs that were completely, you know, useless, I may use that word. Amen. So the Holy Spirit brings us to a place of praise. Praise is to honor God, is to glorify God, is to pay tribute to God, is to bring a neurology before the prayer, to say, God, only you are almighty. So as we sing those songs, it can be a song composed by somebody, maybe joy celebration. You may not necessarily be singing the exact words as they are. Somewhere you may be adding the words that the Holy Spirit has put in your mouth. Hallelujah. And when you do that, the anointing comes down. God starts to step in your situation and break down whatever is trying to break you down in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. So as you praise the Lord, you enjoy also the atmosphere of knowing that while I praise God, God is doing something behind the scene. Amen. All right, so tonight we continue with part 5. This is a long, obviously the topic of the Holy Spirit is long, but we continue with part 5, knowing the character of the Holy Spirit. We are still in the book of John chapter 14, verse 16 to 18. Jesus was speaking. He says, I will pray to the Father, and he will give you another comforter, that he may abide forever. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it sees him not, neither knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. So he dwells with you and shall be in you. He is around you and he's inside you. Hallelujah. Verse 18, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Amen. So on this wonderful journey, we have discovered the wonderful personality of the Holy Spirit. He is a beautiful person. He's got a beautiful nature. Amen. He is God the third in the Trinity of God. And he leads us in green pastures. He leads us into the supernatural. If you have seen miracles, signs and wonders, it is due to the presence of the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, you will never achieve much in life. We need more of the Holy Spirit. You need more of the Holy Spirit. He comes to intervene where your situation is impossible. You tell him, Holy Spirit, take over my battle. He will take over your battle. Therefore, once you know him, you realize that your spiritual journey as a child of God is never meant to be a life of struggle. Your mother raised you with struggle. Your grandmother raised your mother with struggle. Then you also enter into struggle, and your children enter into struggle. That is not the portion God has given us. It does not belong to you, because the Holy Spirit is a helper. So if your grandmother had asked the help of the Holy Spirit, your mother would have been raised well. If your mother had asked the presence of the Holy Spirit in her life, you and I would have been raised correctly. So now, maybe that is past, but you and I are present. As we now engage in the presence of the Holy Spirit, ask the Holy Spirit to lead us, our children will never suffer at all in the name of Jesus. By the leading of the Holy Spirit, we are empowered. We do well. We do better. We go forward. We manifest the blessings of God. The leading of the Holy Spirit leads us into beautiful places, beautiful zones, opportunities, and divine encounters on the way. Hallelujah. All right, let me give you some points again tonight. Pillar number one, we are now looking at his influence upon your blessing. The Holy Spirit has an influence over your life so that you may have a blessing. There is influence upon an anointed. The laying of hands has happened over your life. Oil has been poured upon you, but something is resisting the blessing. So now this is why the Holy Spirit is the helper. What you cannot do, he comes to do. The oil is working in your life, but there's a slowness in the blessing coming into your life. So the Holy Spirit comes to advance that blessing. John chapter 16, verse 7. Jesus said, it is expedient for you that I go away. The word expedient means advantage. It means beneficial. So Jesus was saying, it is beneficial that I go. It is expedient that I go. It is to your advantage that I go. When I go, the help of the Holy Spirit will come in your life that you may be enjoying your supernatural blessings. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit is here as a beneficiary for you and for me, to make you and me benefit in the blessing that God has created for us. Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit comes to advance, to quicken things, to bring things quickly in our lives. I can share many testimonies that I know that have happened while I've been in ministry. People have prayed for, who have had delay in certain things in their lives. And as I prayed for the presence of the Holy Spirit upon them, they received what God had prepared for them. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit's influence is to advantage us, to make us stand with an advantage. Now, if you watch soccer, there are 11 players on each side, all right? And as they play, if one team has 12 people, that team has more players than the other team. So that is an advantage. So the advantage we have is that when you look at yourself, you are not on your own. You have the Holy Spirit next to you. Amen? So in your family, if you say, I've got two kids and a wife and me, we are four. You are more than four. You have the Holy Spirit in that family. So you are more than four. You are advantaged. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, let's look at the inheritance, the blessing. In the book of Romans again, chapter 8, verse 17, the Bible says, if we are children of God, if you and I are born again, then we are heirs of God. An heir is a person who didn't work for something and they receive what the Father worked for, or somebody worked for it. So Jesus paid for our inheritance. He paid for our blessings. This is why Jesus said, I'll send the helper so that the blessing I suffered for, I died for on the cross of Calvary, you may enjoy it. So the Bible says, we are heirs of God and joint heirs with the Lord Jesus Christ. So what belongs to Jesus belongs to you and belongs to me as well. And the things that Jesus paid for on the cross of Calvary, they are called the blessing. They are called an inheritance. Salvation is a blessing. Prosperity is a blessing. An inheritance is salvation. An inheritance is a blessing. And every good thing you can ever think of. This is why the Bible says a good man leaves an inheritance for his children's children. Hallelujah. And the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. So there is the wealth of the other team, the sinner, the unbeliever, that God wants you to have. There are blessings that are being held by wrong people that God wants you to have as a child of God. So the Lord has said to us in his word that the Holy Spirit comes to influence the blessing. You are out there, you're saying, man of God, I've never seen the blessing of God. I've never experienced it. Call upon the Holy Spirit. As you do, you will see the blessing of God. What is the blessing of God? The empowerment of God over your life to make it. God created you that you may make it. And the empowerment he gives you through the Holy Spirit is called the blessing. So the Holy Spirit comes to bring that empowerment over your life. I have people in our ministry and some other people that I know who do not deserve to be where they are. But by the empowerment of the Holy Spirit, we are seeing the blessing of God resting upon them. And we know that God has got more. Hallelujah. God has got more for you. In the book of Numbers, chapter 23, verse 19, you know this scripture. The Bible says, God is not a man. God is not a man that he would do what? He would lie, not change his mind over what he has said. So Jesus said, I'm going to the Father, I'll release the Holy Spirit for your help, for your advancement. And the Bible says, God is not a man that he would lie. So if Jesus said, I've gone back to my Father to release the Comforter for you, it means he didn't lie to us. The Holy Spirit is with us to validate the blessing of God, to validate your existence, to legitimize your blessing in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Let's move on to pillar number two. Pillar number two, he influences our midnight prayers. Christians are praying now. Some of you are praying maybe at midnight. And once in a while as ministry, we have to do overnight prayers. Hallelujah. We learn this from the time of our Lord Jesus Christ in the book of Luke, where he spent the night praying before he appointed his leaders. Amen. So now let's look at a story where two brothers are kidnapped in prison in the book of Acts chapter 16, and how they prayed and how God answered them. In the book of Acts chapter 16 verse 25. The Bible says, at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. So Paul and Silas are in prison. They are locked. They're in a different, difficult situation. Amen. And you and I, I'm sure, know that midnight prayers are difficult. However, if you are influenced by the Holy Spirit, midnight prayers can become a joy of your life. So Paul and Silas are praying in the prison and they are singing. It's not supposed to be like that. It is an hour of sleep. But in the hour of sleep, the Holy Spirit comes upon them to say, wake up and start to pray. To say, wake up and start to sing. Amen. So now when you look at this story, you realize that you need strength to do overnight prayer meetings. You need the Holy Spirit to come into your environment to cause you to pray in the night. There are people who cannot pray in the night. There are people who, the moment sleep catches up with them, they are unable to pray. Even when they wake up in the middle of the night, going maybe to the toilet, it could have been a reason that the Holy Spirit was saying, get up and pray. After you come back from the toilet, start to pray. But they cannot. Amen. And they know they had desire to pray, but they couldn't. So the Holy Spirit comes to help you in the most difficult hours to pray. It may not be midnight as the time. It may be any other time that he prompts you and you are unable to pray. So the Holy Spirit comes to influence your prayers in that very difficult hour. Hallelujah. In the difficult hour, when you are not supposed to be sleeping, when you are not supposed to be doing something else but prayer, he comes to prompt you to pray. There are people who are unable to manage their sleep. And that is a problem. Because when you are controlled by sleep throughout, you will never be able to enjoy midnight prayers. Hallelujah. There are people who sleep every time. They miss the word of God. They miss the voice of God. They want to sleep all the time. The Bible in Proverbs chapter 6 verse 4 says, give not sleep to your eyes. Do not allow every sleep that comes to your eyes overtake you. There are people who will sleep at every time. They will sleep during a meeting. They will sleep during the time that people are having a conversation. They will sleep when they are sitting down. They will sleep when they have drunk their tea. They will sleep in the day. They will sleep in the morning. They will sleep every hour. You say, a man of God, you're exaggerating. I'm not exaggerating. I had a girl in our church who was fired. She was working for the airline. She was fired because of sleeping. I said, this is amazing. What happened? She says, I don't know. My boss would send me to do something. When I get there, I find a friend. We greet. We start talking for 4 or 5 minutes, and sleep overcomes me. When I'm given an assignment, I start doing the assignment. Before I finish it, I just find sleep overcomes me. And so I was lagging with my job because of sleep. Hallelujah. So the Bible says, give not sleep to your eyes. It is not every hour you must sleep. You can't be a sleeping giant. You can't sleep throughout. You cannot afford to sleep throughout. There are moments the Holy Spirit will prompt you. And in that prompting, you need to rise up and pray. Hallelujah. This is why Paul and Silas were prompted. They never planned to pray in the night. They were prompted. They couldn't sleep. They were out there in the night, and suddenly they realized they didn't have sleep. And sometimes the Holy Spirit will take away sleep from you. Don't force yourself to sleep. Amen. Don't get used to sleeping tablets. Some of those days are the days that the Holy Spirit wants you to sleep, to pray, not to sleep, rather. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit influences our midnight prayer, those moments which are difficult. Know when to pray. Sometimes you could be in the kitchen. You are preparing your meal. You are just about to eat your meal. And the Holy Spirit will prompt you to say, leave the meal. Spend 5 minutes and pray. Obey God and you will enjoy the presence of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes you'll be tested. Your lunch is ready. You are hungry. But the Holy Spirit says, spend 2 minutes. Spend 10 minutes. Spend 20 minutes before you touch your food. That is how you will grow to the prompting of those difficult times, midnight prayers, and any other times that you can come in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. The beautiful thing about this kind of prayers is in verse 26. Acts chapter 16, verse 26. The Bible says, suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately the doors were opened and everyone's bands were loosed. This is what midnight prayer can do. Hallelujah. Midnight prayer has the ability to shake satanic foundations. As you pray in those difficult hours, the altar of evil working against you can be demolished. Have got the grace when you've been praying, you get a certain revival within you. That as you are praying, some things that have tied you for years and years, they are broken. Paul and Silas were chained. The gates were closed. The Bible tells me that their chains were broken. The gates were open. Some of you, your gates are still locked. Engage in midnight prayers. You will see your doors open. Some of you, you're going through a situation. You don't know how to conquer it. Engage in the most difficult hour to pray, and God will help you through the presence of the Holy Spirit. The foundation of evil, the altars of witchcraft working against you, they shall be broken in the mighty name of Jesus. That wizard in your village who has controlled your whole generation from one family to another, that wizard will suffer the vengeance of God as you engage into midnight prayers. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So doors open, yokes break down when the Holy Spirit influences us to pray in those most difficult hours. I have learned and I've enjoyed those hours of prayer. I remember the time when the Holy Spirit was training me. For months and months, I couldn't sleep in the night. And sometimes I'll be worried about what would happen in the morning. My body would be tired and all that. But I've learned to grow into it. And today, I don't have time to waste when it comes to prayer. The moment I'm prompted, I just leave what I'm doing, go spend 5 minutes praying. The moment I go to bed, I could even like tonight, I could enjoy my dinner, go to bed. The moment I think today I'm so tired I need to sleep, I'll probably sleep for an hour. I look at the time, I've only slept for an hour. I wake up, I start to pray. And through that, I have known the presence of the Holy Spirit dividing barriers, breaking walls of evil, destroying witchcraft in my family, coming against forces of evil, and God doing miraculous things. Hallelujah. God will do great things in your life as you allow the Holy Spirit to influence your prayers as a child of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Lastly, my last point is in the book of Isaiah chapter 61. My last point, point number three, pillar number three, he is the oil of God. He is the oil of God. First of all, in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 18, the Bible says, then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brethren. When he anointed him, the Spirit of the Lord came upon David. So Samuel is a man of God. He anoints an ordinary man by the name David. When he pours the oil on him, the Spirit of God came upon David. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit is the oil of God. He is the flow of God. What does the oil of God do upon our lives? He does a lot of things. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 61. Isaiah 61, verse 1. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me. Did you see that? So David was anointed, and the Bible confirms that the Spirit of God came upon him. So when you are anointed, the Holy Spirit has come upon you to do certain things. Amen. So the Lord anointed David through the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is upon David. And when we look at Isaiah, it says, number one, to preach. You are out there, you're trusting God to preach. You envy men of God who can preach. You envy how you can get into the word and preach. Allow the anointing to flow through you. The Holy Spirit enables you to divide the word of God correctly, to dissect the word of God correctly, to teach with truth and with boldness. So he comes to do what? To bring the oil of God in your life to become a good preacher. Not someone who is just telling stories. Amen. To become a man who is carrying the word. To have the capacity to bring the word correctly. And people are born again. And people are saved. And people are healed. And people are restored. And people move forward in their lives. You may not be preaching. You may just have somebody visiting you. You know, I was fighting with my wife, and you counsel them. As you counsel them, the Holy Spirit helps you to restore that family. Hallelujah. Or somebody comes to your life and says, you know, I don't know what's happening. I am sick here and there. The Holy Spirit, through the way that you're going to teach that person, will restore that individual. Hallelujah. And then it says, as we go on, so to preach good tidings unto the meek, he has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. I already talked about that. Okay? A brokenhearted person comes to you because of the oil of God over your life. You restore that individual. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are going to restore your family. You are going to restore many who are brokenhearted. You are going to restore many who are discouraged. Hallelujah. Because the Holy Spirit is the oil of God. And the Bible says to proclaim liberty to the captives. Did you see that? You set free certain individuals who are bound by Satan, bound by witchcraft, bound by discouragement. When you speak and you say, my brother, it will be all right. They wonder where are you getting that confidence. They don't know that confidence is not ordinary confidence. It is the presence of the Holy Spirit upon your life. You set them free from the bondage of Satan, from the works of the devil, in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Then number four, he says, and the opening of the prison to them who are bound. There are people who are in prisons. They may not be in physical prisons, but they are in a prison of fear. They are in a prison of witchcraft. They are in a prison of failure. They are in a prison of stagnation. They are in a prison of rising and falling. They are in a prison of just around there. They can't break away. They can't do better. They can't do more. They are educated, but they can't go higher. They are experienced, but their experience counts nothing. That is like a prison. Hallelujah. They are limited. Nobody in the family has ever arisen to a certain position in life. Everybody was just an ordinary worker. Nobody even became a supervisor or a manager. Those are the kind of prisons we're talking about. Nobody ever earned a certain salary in their life. That is a prison we're talking about. So the Holy Spirit, when he comes, as we have learned here, he comes to undo the prison doors. Open your avenues. Open your breakthrough. Open your journey to prosperity. Open your journey to become a somebody. Open your journey for that salary you're trusting God for. Open your journey for that mansion you're believing God for. He comes to remove you from we don't make it. Because when this one makes it, they will give joy to the rest of the family. So that is like a prison. People are bound within certain boundaries. Nobody has ever owned their own house. That is like a prison. Amen. So the Holy Spirit comes to undo that in our lives. The oil of God. He is the oil of God who comes to undo that. When you are anointed, you end up, a broken spirit dries the bones. Proverbs chapter 17 verse 22. So the Bible says, a merry heart does good like medicine. A happy individual is like a person who is carrying medicine for others. So the oil of God comes upon your life so that your heart may be merry, your heart may be happy, and you bring that contagious happiness to somebody else. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You see, there are sicknesses that people go through that have nothing to do with medication. It is because they miss the oil of God in their lives. There are psychological sicknesses, you know that. You know, a person is depressed without a reason. A person is sad without a reason. So now when you receive the oil of God, you receive total gladness. You receive anointing for joy and happiness. The Holy Spirit brings joy and happiness in your life. The Holy Spirit assures you of the future. The Holy Spirit gives you the grace to know that God can tickle your joy, and you are always a bubbling person because of the presence of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So the Holy Spirit is this wonderful person in our lives because he's the oil of God. The Bible says he's the oil of gladness. Amen. He is the oil of gladness. Isaiah again, Isaiah chapter 61. Let's jump down to verse 3. He says, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them the beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning. Hallelujah. So when the Holy Spirit is upon you, you are at peace. You are a happy person. You are rejoicing all the time. Amen. There is no sad moment. There is no sad day. There is no low time, because he carries you as a helper. He helps you to see the future more than you can see of yourself. May the Holy Spirit help you in the mighty name of Jesus. May the blessings of God be yours in the mighty name of Jesus. By the presence of the Holy Spirit, you shall make it in 2020. The COVID that everybody is worried about will not attack you, because the Holy Spirit will shield you from it in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Our churches will fully open because the anointing of the Holy Spirit is irresistible, and God will perform his signs and wonders upon our lives. May you have a beautiful weekend. May God bless you thoroughly. May God bless your journey. May God take you into the area where you want to be, to say, yes, it is worthy being a child of God, to the glory of the Lord. And that your testimony may be heard beyond your borders. Your testimony may go far, that you may become the envy of your enemies in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. I bless you and I command peace for you. May God continue to be with you today and forevermore until I see you again. In Jesus' name, I sign off. This is Dr. Mono from Christian Life Center in Kempton Park, South Africa. We are at number 9 Jubilee Street. As we are going back to our services in the next week, you're welcome to join us. May God keep you and empower you. Shalom.